morning.
I'm going to say one word and then please comment. Airport.
Thank you very much for the question. The airport is on schedule. We hope to have what I would say is a soft opening late September, and that being that the arrival and departure build-out will be complete. There will still be some more work to be done. The actual ribbon cutting we expect in December. And of course, you'll have a couple odds and ends after that. But we're very pleased. There was also an article in one of the publications. I'm not sure if the person taking a picture now. That talked about, no, it wasn't the picture, that's right, it wasn't. Talked about the airport, where it was as far as budget. I want to say this, that we're really, really pleased with the value of money. Of what's taking place here. And in any project of that size, there's going to be changes. Because of where we were in our government budget, we were able to make some improvements to the airport itself. One being that we see the canopies outside that you actually drive under when transport picks up gas. So that was not on the original plan, but it's a million, it's an increase that we were able to do. So from where we were, the Foreign and Commonwealth Office basically saying that we couldn't borrow money to build an airport, and for us to look at a creative way of how to fund the airport, and we did that through a cash flow management program, and we looked at what was desperately needed and necessary to drive our tourism product and our friends and family forward in a timing that needed to start right away and not to continue to talk about. 15 years they talked about starting that airport. So I'm very pleased it started. It will be an ongoing project. If you ever look at the business case, you'll see there are green fields around there for general aviation. We have taxiways, we have strengthening of the runway itself, the 777s, we have lengthening. So we have an ongoing program that we hope will continue parallel to as we develop the island itself.
Thank you.
Good morning. I have three questions. The first question is, we look and we see the airport, but what about what's inside the shell, the manpower to run it, immigration, customs, and how they're being trained to be friendly and humankind, and this way humankind as well?
The very good question, and I think that you're absolutely right. There's two parts of this equation. One is the bricks and mortar, and one is the human capital. And we have said for a long time, the only thing that we could do for the next 7 or 8 months is try to improve the human capital that was available. And if you, the example is that if you think about when you operate the airport with 8 immigration officers compared to 18 immigration officers, how do things flow? So we're comfortable that the need for training is being met. We're comfortable that the identified need for more officers is being met, and this is a process of hiring to take place. And we're comfortable that we understand the increased demand, what it's going to need for both bricks and mortar and human capital.
Thank you. My second question is, what kind of initiative is being given to stakeholders in the industry to invest in young Caymanians? And I want to say this, we have a lot of people, you know, doing stuff for PR to put on their applications for other people to get work permits, but I'm talking about core hiring of Caymanians and development within the company.
I think the question is, what is being done to make sure Caymanians are hired
and develop throughout the company, not just at the bottom, as bottom feeders, but going throughout the company in the development
stage? Okay, let me specifically talk about my ministry. Right? Cayman Airways, the CEO, percent of the employees here are Caymanian. The CEO is Caymanian. The management team itself is Caymanian. If there's a short-term need for expertise, I think precedent has been set that they brought that in. Turtle Farm is represented here today. I think it's safe to say that Mr. Timmy Adams and Jim Hyde are Caymanian. And they have an 86% employee Caymanian with training programs. So we have to realize that we have a growing country and we have a vibrant tourism product that spins off into the economy, and there are need for labor that the Caymanian population can't meet. And I emphasized earlier in my remarks that one of the driving forces for each one of us every day is to empower young Caymanians. And each person you see here from CIPA and from tourism has spent time at the hospitality school to make sure we continue to drive that initiative forward. So that's by example what we're trying to do.
And finally, we have an excellent product that can be derailed by crime. What is being done to safeguard our tourists when it comes to crime in Cayman Islands? Thank you.
I think we'll take that from an overarching government reaction to crime. If you see that this year, we funded the police department, the uniform branches, with more funds than they ever had available. And we did that in a strategic way of when there were recommendations made, more community policing is needed. That'll take a certain amount of money. A Coast Guard is needed. That'll take a certain amount of money. Marine police is needed. That'll take a certain amount of money. So the money was given in that way with action items attached to it and a way to look and see what the deliverable is supposed to be and it's being delivered. So I reiterate that what the government has the ability to do is vote money for the force and enforcement of it. But that remit falls under the government and security. Security Council is working closely. There's major initiatives going forward. And from tourism, we feel comfortable that we participate and give our input and acknowledge your statement that it's extremely important for us to control crime.
If I can add to that, Minister, from specifically the tourism DOT side, we were directly talking about partnerships with the police on messaging in terms of helping our private sector know how to ensure that guests are going to be safe on the property. And in enforcement events, I think that's how we work together to ensure that both the guests and the stakeholder know the process to support that guest in that area. We've also worked with specifically on areas that we need support. So they've been very enthusiastic with the community policing program to support us with that. So it's not something that we'll go out and talk about directly, but it is something that's top of mind to us as tourism grows. We know there are instances where
there could be
situations that are war-wise. So we are working directly with them as a partner to discuss.
Any more questions?
Minister, as a small operator, a one-bedroom rent out, an Airbnb, thank you very much for being on you. Being small, Airbnb's fees are quite low, which is wonderful. VRBOs are higher. VRBO, however, allows me to very specifically set a room rate and a tax rate. Airbnb does not. Would you please comment about the potential for pushing or engaging Airbnb to allow me to separately put a tax rate so that I'm not paying government taxes on my taxes?
Thank you very much for the question. I'm very happy to hear that you're using Airbnb and it sounds like it's giving you some success. We engaged with Airbnb because we wanted to put you in front of them and them in front of us. The commitment and the memorandum of understanding is that they will actually send people here to dialogue with their customers and that they will have two seminars per year that will be open and then have appointments. So the exact question that you asked, I think, is extremely important to understand that instead of this working in isolation and we have 50 people in Georgia that are using Airbnb, and what they know is that their company that started in Los Angeles or San Francisco, we brought it closer home. And by engaging with them and signing this agreement, we will be able to understand what the options are. From the standpoint of the actual Department of Tourism and Recreation.
Sure. So we have spoken directly to Airbnb about taxes and how it's structured on their site. I'd encourage you to be occupancy as at the department because there's some tricks around doing that with the back end that we've learned. We always remind individually it's a large company. Our first step is this MOU. It will allow us to have direct conversations and work through the agencies that report to our destination. But this is, of course, a large step. And that, again, I encourage you to pop in to talk with the team about how we're structuring that with some other properties because I know it's come up before.
Good morning, Minister and panel. Thank you for coming out this morning. Certainly, some very positive things that are coming in the future, and I commend you all for all the work that you're doing in the tourism arena. Just wondered, in relation to a very delicate balance between cruise and stayover tourism, it's something that I think our destination has always battled with and struggled with. Comment on any plans for the future in terms of trying to maintain that balance. I hear that for the stayover for target market, we're targeting the more affluent travelers, more discerning travelers, which sometimes you don't get, or a lot of times you don't get in the cruise space. So any plans on trying to maintain that balance, and any plans on trying to reflect targeting maybe cruise lines that have similar market to ours?
Thank you, Kim. Good question. So the balance that we need and work toward every day is that we would really like the best of both worlds. And we would like to have the most affluent cruiser, and we would like to have the affluent luxury visitor. There is a balance that must be met with that. We realize that. It's a big part of the national tourism plan, how it goes forward. We've got a carrying capacity that we need to look at. We have an opportunity that we need to look at. So, to give you an example of the threshold for becoming an entrepreneur in cruise is a lot less than the threshold for becoming an entrepreneur in stayover. And I say that from the standpoint of building order and building a couple of rooms in comparison to buying a taxi. But the rewards are very similar from the standpoint that it's a sustainable business that you can continue in and make a very good living and contribution to your lifestyle. I think that our obligation as a government is to understand how we make that available to the people of Cayman Islands and balance it and manage it. And that's why we started this year with the National Tourism Plan to work toward the exact question that you asked, how do we get the most out of both and balance? So we're very aware of the question.
More questions? I have one. Respect to the airline, obviously the gateways and destinations are important part of the strategy, and also the national airline plays a role in all of that. And over the years, we've had an increasing number of other airlines serving the destination, which I think is good. But can you say a little bit about how that might impact the national airline, whether you have any new gateways or destinations planned, and how the influx of other airlines, which is good for bringing more tourists here, how that might be impacting the national airline as well.
Thank you very much, Paul. Let me start off by saying that sometimes Cayman Airways is put at a disadvantage because they have to contribution that Cayman Airways makes is really to the development of the country and the income of the country. So example being, if you bring the New York route, which is an extremely successful JFK route, if you bring tourists, stayovers from there, and they spend $7,000 a week on average, and it costs you an equity of $250 per person bringing there, obviously the GDP of the country has been upped by what has just taken place. So we see a tremendous reward for Cayman Airways and the involvement. The other thing that CAL does is that it helps control the price of what a gateway charges to get to the Cayman Islands. So as an example, if you search Expedia, you'll see a lot of different specials. Sometimes they're driven by Cayman Airways because they lower their price because it's a shoulder season and they want more people. But when they lower their price, it just lowers the price. So it's probably the smallest for this country that has limited ways of influencing. It's one of the tools that we have that we can use. Now, in that context, when you have certain gateways that make major contributions to your tourism product, then you have certain gateways that the airline itself, in their management structure, calls a core route, which has always been a friends and family, and basically an insurance policy of the country for a bad weather, a hurricane that can get people in and out in emergencies. And let's just take Miami as an example. If we look at Miami, what we've seen take place in the last year is we've got daily flights by Southwest out of Fort Lauderdale. We've got three flights a day by American Airlines. We've got daily flights starting shortly by JetBlue out of Fort Lauderdale. And we've seen increases in arrivals from that gateway and that area of South Florida, which is what the country wants. And it's not exactly what Cayman Airways wants if you look at their business model and say you're directed to make a profit or drive revenue on that gateway. So it's a very competitive fight that they're in. But the mission of Cayman Airways, and it's looked at and managed, and the question is asked, are there other gateways? And I'll use Dallas as an example. Dallas is now served by America, but it wasn't served by America until Cayman Airways put a flight in it. And the reaction in the market was that Americans said all of a sudden, wow, there are people that really want to go directly to Cayman, so we're going to start a Dallas flight. There's no reason for Cayman Airways to fly to Dallas anymore because the market's being met and the country's getting the GDP needs and the revenue out of that gateway. So CAL now looks at another gateway to open in the exact same way to increase the benefit to the country itself. And when you look at centers of wealth where you want to open your gateways. Governor Phelps.
Thank you. Good morning. Staying on the same topic, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that sometime over the Christmas, Cayman Airways had a direct route to San Diego, California. Can you or Cayman Airways or the ministry department say if there are other plans to pursue that, and so what sort of time it would be, if you can speak to open up the West Coast?
No, absolutely happy to speak to it. The charter was a ring kiss here for some of the engagement they had. We were very excited about that. The look at new gateways is
not in hotels, but in other types of accommodation, condominiums, guest houses, the Airbnb type properties, and so on. There's a problem that's based in Cayman, based entities that are using them on an IDA base for booking and payment in the Cayman Islands up to this point. Banking system here does not provide us IBAN numbers, international banking account numbers, and it's a big issue. And the result of what has happened with Expedia acquisition and the VRBO HomeAway and so on, and with the way Booking TripAdvisor and the way that Airbnb work, is it ends up costing us quite a bit more because they have to be intermediaries now that really we could hopefully avoid and not be so expensive on a per rental basis. Is it possible, sir, that your ministry could collaborate with the finance ministry, collaborate with the financial services industry to get this sorted out? Because we're competing with BDI and they have IBAN numbers.
I believe it's incumbent upon us, Tim, thank you very much for the question, for us to do our very best to deal with it. And Nisha's just going to bring you up to speed on we have identified it as a problem already and what we're doing now. Paying down a couple options, but it's not satisfactory.
That you know, we've started turning the stake options, and we'll definitely have to talk with the Ministry of Finance on that. But at this time, there are other options. We know that it's not favorable in terms of for the guest experience, but we'll commit to doing that on the agenda.
Thank you. Minister, earlier there was a question at the very beginning, actually, where someone posed a one word question. I thought it was very cool myself. I've always wanted to do that. Well, I've heard this by saying that when I say my one word question, bear in mind that we do have to go home today. It might take a bit longer for you to answer it. So if you can give a summary version of your answer to this question. Port.
Not only one word, it's 74 letters. You want a long answer based on how you were prefacing the question. I got assigned this ministry with the premier in 2013. Very happy to get my constitutional responsibilities. When I came to the ministry, there was a business case that had been started by the Honorable Klein Clinton, preceding me as Minister of Tourism. This case had to be started because of where we were under guidance from the Foreign Commonwealth Office, that any project, a capital project, over $10 million demanded a business case. PwC, extremely well-known firm globally, won the bid for the business case and did a study on port development in the Cayman Islands, and we waited for the results. When we ran for election, PPM government in that year, we campaigned on the cruise berthing facility in the Georgetown port area, and we were elected on that mandate. So for us, it was very important what the business case came back and said, because two things. If the business case had come back and said it's not something that is in the best interest of the country economically, it obviously PPM government campaigned on. And we also said that after the environmental impact assessment was done, was deemed to be a risk of damage to Seven Mile Beach, which we know is an economic driver for us, we would stop. So after a period of time when that came back, the business case showed that there was an economic value to the cruise berthing facility, and compounded on that, there's an economic cargo facility, because we must do something about the cargo that arrives on this island. We have no choice but to have a port to receive cargo. The ships are getting bigger, they need more draft, you have to do some dredging, you have to improve the facility, and those are the things that are common.
was quite a conversation, and a very valid conversation, about what this environmental impact was and how it affected our future. We stepped back as a government and we said, we are going to re-look at business case, because the business case was RFP put out that it would be the best value per dollar. And the best value per dollar in building the facility was built in shallow water, because it was going to cost more to do it in deep water. So we basically took 1 year and another election cycle and asked here to come back and do a value study that if the piers could be put in deeper water, if there could be less environmental impact from dredging, what would that look like if it was possible? Here it came back and said that it was possible, and then we had Mac McDonald, another globally recognized firm, to a peer review on what peer had given as far as being able to be done. And that came back in the affirmative that it could be done. So we moved forward on those reports. Now, in the next election cycle, we formed a coalition government, but we campaigned in Georgetown on the cruise-worthy facility going forward, along with the cargo facility in combination. And again, the majority was returned on that manifesto item. And the coalition government agrees with the position going forward that the research that has been done and the business case that has been done supports the forward. After that, there was another bid put out, and KPMG won the bid to look at the procurement model of could this be done with some criteria that the government put forward, which was no government guarantee, and the combination of cargo and cruise being in one bid and being paid for in one way. That was done by KPMG. They asked for pre-qualification, and the importance of pre-qualification was that if MK Construction of Cayman Brack had given a bid, there's no such company by the way, but just an example, and that bid came in at $75 million, it would skew the way it was looked at, because they couldn't build it for that. So it had to be an RFP of globally recognized firms that qualify under the KPMG model for the RFP. That came back, there were 11 pre-qualified global companies that were approved. Then the next step was to ask those companies for an invitation to submit outline solutions based on the criteria. So that was sent out. That's where we are. We have received that back to 9 that were selected out of that from the RFP pre-qualified. The 9 have sent in their solutions, and that is with the procurement committee, which will go to central tenders to have a look at it once procurement led by KPMG approves us. Thank you. Successful launch. There's been a very positive feedback. We hope to get American on board to do it as well. We hope to offer it to other airlines at other airports. So, I don't know if it is the working group was the United States Homeland Security at the very top level, along with Deputy Governor and Mr. Wesley Howell, and Mike Greenbanks here, who did a very good job consulting with the other ministries and driving it forward. Mr. David White was in Miami on Friday, again welcoming and being involved.
Thank you. Any further questions?
Two words that are very dear to your heart, human right. I'm just wondering, years ago, and maybe even in recent years, it was something that attracted a lot of general aviation community to Cayman Islands, called the Cayman Caravan. And my recollection is it came down to Grand Cayman, and the activities were primarily here. But I'm wondering whether there's an opportunity to instead develop that same concept but going to Cayman Brac, where the air traffic control loads are more, perhaps spaces could be developed for the parking for all those aircraft, and a whole program developed around bringing them here, because these are generally high spenders, similar to the, you know, the sport fishing community. They tend to drop $50 when they do them, and maybe put Cayman Brac on the map with a bit of a specialty for that community and develop a whole new niche.
When the took place, Cayman Brac used to partner with them. Do you know anybody that has a private pilot's license?
Sir, you call me, is that right?
The point is that we'd be happy to partner with somebody who has some type of initiative that they want to discuss, and we would welcome initiatives like that.
Yeah, would it be DOT or the ministry that would be appropriate? Because I've got some really cool ideas now that Cuba seems to relax the air corridors restrictions and so on, where general aviation would be a really fun flight down, you know, with the flight plan. Looks like a cool thing to do, and some of the distances are really short, like in between some of the airports in Cuba, just to pick them up, for example. It's a bit more fun than even coming to Grand Cayman, actually, because of the route and distances involved.
Just call me, happy to talk about it.
Cool, thanks a lot.
Thank you. Any further questions? Seems that we're good with questions now. I just want to say thanks again to the Honorable Minister and all the senior officials from the Ministry, including Councillor David as well, for coming out and talking to our members about all these issues. So please thank them. We are there behind the scenes trying to ensure that the policy environment is the right one for you. And so we want you to come forward and let us know if there are any issues, any concerns that you have. And it may sound like it's a small thing, it may seem like it's a small thing to your particular business, but we may discover that actually there are many other businesses facing a similar issue. Like the Airbnb issue you heard earlier, and other ones as well was mentioned. So I ask you to please feel free to come forward, send the office an email, call us, let us know there's anything at all that you think we can help with, because that's what we're here for. And yes, I have a question here,
this is
yeah.
thanks very much. And what I was saying about advocacy work that we're doing, we need your input, but we're also going to need your support and your participation in the roundtable sessions which are coming up, so those downstairs soon. So please look out for those emails and that. Try to attend, because when you attend, it's actually all about you and your business. It's all about what your concerns are. It's all about how what you need for your success in your business and how we can help ensure the environment's right for you. So that's what the purpose of those sessions are. So please try to take some time out of your about 2 hours to come out to the sessions with the group. Once again, thanks to all of you. Thanks to everyone. Enjoy the rest of your day.